The Polsky Practical Personal Enrichment Series is underwritten by the Polsky Family Supporting Foundation in partnership with the Johnson County Community College Foundation, which seeks to educate and empower the public in the areas of health, financial independence, and topical issues not covered elsewhere.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We'll go ahead and get started. Welcome to Johnson County Community College, and welcome to the Nerman Museum. My name is Paul Kyle. I'm Dean of Student Services and Success here at the college, and it's great to have you for tonight for the Polsky Practical Personal Enrichment Series lecture featuring Elizabeth Washburn. Elizabeth Washburn, who is here to share with us her inspirational work with combat veterans, helping them to express themselves and share their experiences through art. It's special to have her with us, and I'll do a formal introduction a little bit later, but I've got some more Polsky series introductions and housekeeping things to do. We typically have the Polsky series in the Polsky Theater, but tonight, because it's art, we felt like it might be a way to go is to be in the Nerman Museum with the art itself. And so we encourage you also, if you haven't been here, to make your way out the doors and around, because the museum will be open till 9 o'clock tonight. So after this, we encourage you to, if you haven't been here, to walk around and see the exhibits around in the art museum. And it'll close at 9 o'clock. The Polsky Practical Personal Enrichment Series was established in 1997. And is underwritten by the Norman and Elaine Polsky Family Supporting Foundation in partnership with the JCC Foundation. This series seeks to educate and empower the public in the areas of education, health, wellness, financial stability, and other issues covering that are not covered elsewhere. We are honored to have the continuing support of the Polsky family, and I'm not sure, do we have any Polsky family members here in the audience? I'd like to give them a hand anyway. It's a wonder to have them continually support the what Norman and Elaine started years ago. Before I introduce the speaker, I want to tell you what's in your booklet you received when you came in. The green cards, if you'll take those, feedback, because we want to know your thoughts about this tonight, as well as any other Polsky series types of events. And give us your feedback. What do you like about it? If you have a featured speaker we ought to be considering, put those in those cards, and so we can get feedback from you. Also on the cards is information if you'd like to give us, share your email, so we can kind of keep you informed of what's going on with the Polsky series. Get that to us, as well as you'll see the Polsky series at jcc.edu to contact us for information. The blue cards, those after the presentation, Elizabeth will answer questions from the audience. So if you're kind of shy and don't want to speak into one of the mics and ask the question, you can put your question on the cards. I'll take those, and we'll ask Elizabeth from the cards. So that's what the blue cards are for. And finally, the envelope in there also supporting our Veterans Scholarship Fund here at JCC Foundation. Helps student veterans achieve their educational dreams, and so we hope you considered honoring our veterans in that way. Our next Polsky series event will be February 11th. Joining us in that evening will be Dr. Jeffrey Burns of the KU Alzheimer's Disease Research Center. Dr. Burns has been a Polsky speaker before, very popular speaker, and he'll talk more as far as Alzheimer's prevention. Again, that's February 11th. Also, if you need more information, please look out the website, www.jccc.edu/Polsky Series, for more information about the Polsky Series, as well as videos from previous events. So it kind of gave you an idea of what we've had in the Polsky Series previously. It is now my pleasure to introduce tonight's speaker. Visual artist Elizabeth Washburn has been working with service members transitioning out of the war zone for the past several years. In 2010, she founded the Combat Arts San Diego, where she provides free art classes, public art opportunities, museum tours, art exhibitions for active duty service members and veterans. Elizabeth uses her professional experience as an artist and an art teacher to help service members and veterans to access the art as a means of self-expression and healing. In addition to her to teaching art for over a decade, Elizabeth has a master's degree in painting from the Laguna College Art and Design, and a bachelor's degree in fine arts. Her exhibits and her work is nationally known in galleries and museums. She's also a native Kansan and alumni from Blue Valley High School, West High School. Okay, North. Okay, I get it right. It says West, but I got North. All right. Please help me in welcoming Elizabeth Washburn.
Good evening. He's done all my introduction, so I'll try not to repeat myself too much. Again, my name is Elizabeth Washburn. I'm an artist who founded a nonprofit organization called Combat Arts. It is located in San Diego. I do things, obviously, outside of San Diego, here at Johnson County Community College and the Nerman Contemporary Museum of Art. I did graduate from Blue Valley North and also took a couple of classes at Johnson County Community College, and it has changed enormously. It's a hugely impressive place. My experience here, I've been here since Saturday, working with Johnson County Community College student veterans to create this beautiful artwork over here, as well as interacting with employees of the Contemporary Museum, and the whole experience has been really, really impressive. It's a real honor to be here. Thank you very much for coming. So I'm going to spend some time showing you what I do with my organization with Combat Arts. I'm going to share with you some of the art that's been created by the combat vets. I'm going to also show you some of my own work. The fact that I am an artist is instrumental in the work that I do. It's really important for me to clarify that I'm not a therapist, and with certain audiences, there's a mistake that since I'm using art as a therapeutic tool, that I'm an art therapist, but I'm not an art therapist. I'm an artist and art teacher. So just to get started, Combat Arts is coming up. And with Combat Arts, as my introduction talked about, I provide art classes for returning combat veterans from Iraq and Afghan wars. We teach them about basic drawing and painting skills, and we also teach about how to take some of their thoughts and ideas about their war experiences and put them into pictures, creating art as a means of self-expression. In addition to the art classes, I also provide museum tours. Combat Arts is partnered with the Timken Museum of Art, which is in San Diego, as well as the Contemporary Museum, Museum of Contemporary Art in San Diego. The museum partnerships are really, as obviously, you know, as right now states, a hugely beneficial thing for such a small organization as mine because they have such a broader reach. Through the cultural tours, through the museums, I'm able to give a little art history to veterans as well as teach them about how to view art in such a way that is not alienating. So it's a way to look at art in such a way that they can identify with it. So between the Timken Museum, which is wholly focused on old masterworks, like they've got a Rembrandt in there, they're learning about art from the past, as well as the Contemporary Museum's collection, which is all about art from living artists. So it's a really broad gambit, and I find it really useful being able to put some of the ideas that we do in class into context by showing them some of the artwork within the museums. So the cultural tours are a big component of my organization. Another thing we do is public art opportunities. This is something that's just happened in the last year, where I created a project called the Veteran Mural Project, where we engage with communities in San Diego, where the veterans actually come out, meet with neighborhood groups, and have conversations about potential sites and content for artwork within their neighborhoods. The benefit of this is that it works to advocate and educate, so it advocates for the veterans and their the veterans' issues, or just how hard it is to transition from war it back into regular life. And it also educates the public about these individuals not being scary people, you know, learning more about post-traumatic stress as something that is not a disorder so much. Disorder, usually commonly known as something that's abnormal condition, whereas basically their reactions to their very abnormal events are extremely normal. So it's a way to try to engage the public, interact with the public, bring the civilians together with the military, which is really important because the military is like a subculture. You know, there's not a lot of interaction between civilians and military. So artwork works as a really great catalyst between the two. This is a recent one. The building to the right is where this mural is going. They're actually going to be, this original is actually 5 by 6 feet, pretty much about the same size as this painting over here. And then it's going to be sent to a scanner. The whole thing's going to be scanned, and then it's going to be printed 10 by 12 feet. A metal frame is going to be built that the print is then going to be stretched on, and that building right there is where it's going to be located. And it's a very popular neighborhood in San Diego. It's going to get a lot of visits by just the public. It's really important to get the public engaged because not everybody goes to galleries and museums to see art. So I like to try to get things out into the streets. Speaking of in the galleries, we also do these art exhibitions. They also serve to educate and advocate. It's a great opportunity for the public to have an intimate interaction with veterans through the artwork. It's also a great way to celebrate the artistic achievements of the veterans' work. We've had a lot of success. A lot of times we partner with other organizations like music therapy groups. So we'll have music as well as creative writing groups. So we'll have written or oral performances of creative writing by veterans in addition to the visual art. The other thing that's really beneficial about these exhibitions is the veterans are bringing their families, so it's also a way for them to have more communication with their loved ones about some of their issues through the artwork. It's also fun just to bring the kids because it's an opportunity for, you know, mom or dad, because I do work with, there's male and female combat veterans. So largely I've worked with usually men, but there have been a handful of women that have gone through my program. I will probably, for the rest of the talk, say guys, just because it's quicker, but it is men and women. This is something else that we've done, an exhibition at a middle school, high school in La Jolla. It's a part of San Diego, trying to educate young people. Since this school where this exhibition happened was 6th through 12th grade, some of the kids in that school have been alive since they've been alive. The wars have been constantly happening. So since their birth, you know, we've been at war in Iraq and Afghanistan. The other thing that's really cool about this is that they have a chapel. So the chaplain really wanted a piece of artwork in his chapel. So that stayed up for a couple of weeks last Veterans Day. Another place that we have exhibitions is community colleges, like here, also in San Diego. There's a Southwestern College. It's also wonderful because teachers will bring their classrooms full of kids through, or the students through the exhibit. I'll give presentations to the students to help bridge gaps between understanding between military and civilian experiences, so specifically combat vet experiences. Predominantly, combat arts is focused on combat veterans, just because we're so small. It's hard to reach out to all populations. And I included this picture because in some of these other pictures, you'll notice that there's nobody in them. So there actually, people do come to these exhibitions. Quite a few people do come. So I just wanted to make sure that was clear. Recently, we did a exhibition in a library. That's a really cool place to do it too, because then you're accessing a whole new group of people that haven't had the opportunity to maybe engage with, you know, what's going on with vets returning back and transitioning back into life after war. And then finally, we also do interactive public works to bring the veterans. It's a really good, a lot of times when a veteran will be receiving treatment for post-traumatic stress, one of the big things that happens is they have a tendency to isolate. And so because of the symptoms from post-traumatic stress, they have a tendency to have really strong anxiety, really strong hypervigilance from their experiences. And so figuring out ways to get them back into the public and interacting in the public is a great way to just start the process of healing and moving forward so that they're not isolating so much. So combat arts, actually, talking about post-traumatic stress, combat arts actually started off in, I started off in 2007 calling up the Balboa Naval Hospital asking if they would like free art classes after I read a couple too many articles about some Marines being killed in Iraq. It was around the time of the surge when Bush sent in about 30,000 troops into Iraq to quell some of the chaos that was going on there, and there were a lot of American casualties during that time. So it was one of those moments of, you know, what can I do? Well, what can I do is I can make art and I can teach art. So I called them up, asked if they'd be interested, and so I ended up at the Balboa Naval Hospital teaching art to wounded warriors who were there receiving treatment. And then after a few years, I was asked to come to a brand new treatment facility specifically focused on combat-related post-traumatic stress. So that's essentially how combat arts is wholly focused on combat veterans. It's really happened completely organically. So I came to OASIS. It's a inpatient treatment facility on the Point Loma submarine base in San Diego. They live there for 10 weeks receiving a variety of therapies, and they also include things like yoga, visual arts, music, and that's where I've been in addition to a couple other places, but that's the main place that I've been since 2010. In addition to teaching art at OASIS, I also, in this last year, have moved to Veterans Village in San Diego, which is a residential facility that has all of the same kind of treatments as OASIS does with the post-traumatic stress, but they also focus a lot on substance abuse treatment, as well as finding jobs and just kind of, you know, day-to-day things that need to be taken care of for homeless veterans. So specifically, the veterans that are at VVSD, Veterans Village of San Diego, are homeless. A lot of times what people don't realize is these guys are getting released from the military and walking off the military base directly onto the streets, and they are homeless. So I don't, and young ones. So it's not the stereotype that you have in your head of the guy that you see, you know, not that individual doesn't also deserve help and treatment, but it's a lot of people. It's a lot more than you would think. So that's been a new thing for combat arts, is to locate into VVSD as well as OASIS. And then me as an artist, everything's based on the fact that I'm an artist. I've been teaching for such a long time. In addition to teaching art to combat vets, I also teach art to kids in juvenile hall and kids in inner city schools. And I have firsthand experienced the transformational process that the arts can have on an individual. So many times I can't count it. So I know that the process of making art is inherently therapeutic. I've experienced it myself, and I watch it happen in others. And it's all based on, all the work that I do is based on my own art practice. So right now I'm showing you a few of my recent works. I wanted to show these to you because not all of my work is revolving around combat veterans. I still have an independent artistic life that doesn't always engage with combat-related ideas within my own personal work. So these are a few paintings that are are, I'm not going to get too much into my own work because that's not the point, but these are, just to give you an idea, reflections on some time I spent in Sinai. I lived in Egypt for a year and a half. And then in addition to exhibiting in museums and galleries, I also do portrait commissions and painting commissions. I am an artist, so I do everything art-related in order to make a living. I have no shame. I don't do pet portraits, though, so please don't ask me for pet portraits. the other thing that I do is mural commissions, painting and mural commissions. That's part of the reason why I got a little knack for figuring out the process for people to create artwork when they've never made art before. I've been making murals for, you know, almost 20 years, and so that's something that has also helped me engage with veterans and be successful in their being able to make art with no background in art. So here's a couple of examples of those. I used to work for a mural company, and we specialized in murals for Vegas. So they were gigantic. You know, it would be like 8,500 square feet of literally 8,500 square feet of miles. So kind of have the mural thing figured out after that. Then in 2010, I went to graduate school, and I ended up getting my master's degree. And I ended up focusing on the work that I was doing at OASIS as the focus of my thesis. Originally, I had no intention of focusing on combat vets for my thesis because, number one, I felt it was a little bit exploitive, and number two, I felt like, why would I make pictures about other people's experiences? However, it has been such a profound thing to work with these individuals. I have learned so much. My own perception of who these people are has changed so gigantically. I grew up in a family with not a lot of military background at all. I had a lot of stereotypes myself. They're macho. They're, you know, maybe not the sharpest tools in the shed. Some really stereotypical ideas about military, which has completely been changed. There's some of the brightest students that I have, extremely quick to learn, extremely kind, and best of all, extremely funny. So it's always a good time. I actually have a great time working with vets. This piece is titled Morality, basically because there is a suspension of morality in combat that has to happen in order for an individual to survive. The little girl to the right has a few meanings in this piece where she is, number one, obviously a symbol for innocence. She also is an observer of what's going on. And finally, there's a whole bunch of combat vets that have had some really horrific experiences involving children in combat that they have a really hard time dealing with when they get back. This piece, in addition to, when I was making these paintings, I was so worried about being exploitive that I would start bringing them to OASIS to show the guys as like full disclosure that I'm making art about this. And it actually turned out to be really positive. They especially really like this piece. They, you know, a couple of them were like, that's totally spot on. And so it was it was something that I was, you know, again, I was very worried about using other people's experiences, especially such intense experiences as this. But it has turned out actually sharing my art has kind of opened me up. So I think it makes it a little bit easier for them to connect with me too. This piece is called Futility. It relates to specifically Afghanistan and all of the foreign conquerors that have come in trying to occupy a tribal place, which is basically a feudal endeavor because they essentially are tribal. So the idea of bringing in some of our Western ideas about democracy and so forth don't really relate to this this country of people. And I feel to a certain degree personally that it's a futile endeavor to send our guys there, and the blood on the wall up there represents all the other powers that have moved through Afghanistan. This one is called Solitary Confinement. This is interesting in two ways, in that the figure is actually a woman. She has really short hair, so you can't really tell, but she was a woman that went through treatment at OASIS, and this was actually a scene that she, or a pose that she did for a mural being done in one of the groups at OASIS. And the pose was so strong, I asked her if I could use it and paint it. And essentially, it's referring to that idea of how when you do have post-traumatic stress, you are going to have a tendency to isolate because it's a little bit easier than dealing with all of the outside things that you can't control. So she's in a room by herself with memories of combat going on behind her, kind of like projected on the walls. What's interesting is I brought this one to Oasis 2 to show the guys, and some of the guys recognized the pictures of being there. And so they were actually pointing to the painting saying, I was there. And the thing is they actually were there because the photos that I was using came from a Marine who was in one of my classes who was given a disc of photos from a combat photographer named Scott Peterson who was embedded with his Marine unit in Fallujah. So these individuals were also in the Marines unit that gave me the photos. So they were actually pointing at these pictures, recognizing these places. And essentially, the tank on the right was a situation where some insurgents had gotten a hold of one of their guys, and they were outside about to go in and rescue him. So that was really profound. This one is multiple tours of duty. This painting refers to the 2012 March massacre that happened in Afghanistan. There was an army sergeant who left his camp and went out and killed 16 innocent Afghans. Now, the reason why this is important to me is that a lot of my focus is on the mental health, negative impact on mental health that multiple tours of duty have on these guys. This individual was on his fourth tour. He had documented mental issues going on from his combat experiences. And for me personally, these are the kind of things that need to be talked about because this is something that I feel could have been prevented. So basically the figure is overwhelmed with all the weight on his back. And all of those blankets, there's 16 blankets there, and they're all representing the 16 victims from that event. And this individual now is spending the rest of his life in prison, and he's a father of three. So I think that is something that really needs to be figured out, is this sending these guys so many times. Finally, this one is titled Battle. It's a Pashtun word. There's this code of ethics that's been around for about 2,000 years called Pashtun Wali in Afghanistan, and they're largely Pashtun tribal people. And essentially, it's a code of ethics whereby battle is essentially, in our context, would be an eye for an eye. So as soon as something happens to one of them, they need to seek revenge. And the individual to the right is a Marine Special Forces guy that was in one of the Oasis classes, and I learned a lot from him about all of the interactions that would go on between the military leaders in country, in Afghanistan, with the tribal elders trying to create some sort of understanding or some sort of not necessarily peace, but trying to figure out a way to rid those areas of the Taliban people, of Taliban fighters. But the fact of the matter is that because of their Pashtun Wali, because of their code of ethics, you just never really know who's gonna follow through with what's being said. So it's a comment just on here we are trying to have an interaction, but at the same time, there is no solution. Next thing I want to do is just throw some numbers at you. I swear this will get lighter later. Just some numbers that I think that people don't realize. There have been over 2.5, this is a number from 2013, of 2.5 million American troops have been deployed to the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. I don't know if people really realize how many of our Americans have served. Of those, a third of them were deployed more than once, which is a number that's over 800,000. And of that, 37,000 have been deployed more than five times. And 400,000 service members have done three or more deployments. These numbers are all numbers that come from, I always get numbers from the VA and the congressional reports because I always assume that they're going to be the most conservative. So you could probably assume that these numbers are larger. This was from a congressional research report from 2012, or excuse me, 2002 to 2012. Over 250,000 service members have been diagnosed with a traumatic brain injury. So many people are getting blown up because of all the improvised explosive devices. So that's a huge number of individuals who are having traumatic brain injuries that are long-lasting when they return home. And then in addition, over 100,000 service members have been diagnosed with post-traumatic stress disorder. This is a very conservative number. It's also from 2012, and it's also from a congressional report, which it's probably not in their best interest to go high with their numbers. The final number is something that I thought it was 16, and this is why I included it in my presentation, is I didn't realize it was up to 22 veteran suicides a day. So we're talking about every 65 seconds a veteran is committing suicide. So these kind of ideas, or not these numbers and these statistics, and is part of why I do what I do, is because I feel that it is a civic duty to pay more attention to what's going on, and if we make the decision that we're going to send these guys to war, then we need to follow up when they get home. Now what I'd like to do is just share with you some of the artwork that's been created in my classes. Usually I'll start off the class. Basically, most of the murals that you're going to see here are going to fall into a few different themes. One will be symbols representing things. The second will be past, present, future. So it'll be what were you doing? What was life in the past? How are you today? And what do you hope for in the future? In the classes, I work with groups of veterans that run from anywhere from 5 to 10 guys at a time. We call them cohorts. So in each cohort, there's between 5 and 10 guys, and they work collaboratively to come up with a concept. And then we work, and I'm going to show you some pictures of the process in a second. Then we work together to come up with images that we can work from, and then the final artwork. The battlefield cross that you see is the rifle in the boots with the Kevlar is representative of fallen soldiers. I don't know how familiar people are with that, but I think that's a pretty fairly common or understood symbol. This symbol is a caduceus. It is a symbol for the medical corps, for the Army. This cohort had quite a few corpsmen, and corpsmen are very well liked in most groups because they are the ones that save everybody's lives when they're out in the field. So there was quite a few corpsmen, so they made the decision to make the caduce. Something that's interesting about the caduce is that actually that symbol, it's Greek, and in like 1902, the Army decided to put it on their uniform. The medical corps decided to put it on their uniform, but actually the symbol for medicine in Greece is actually a rod of Asclepius, and this is actually is representative of Hermes. It's actually Zeus's younger son, so it's just kind of interesting, but they had, this is in 1902, it's been adopted, and so it's been brought forth into the present. And so as far as the military, anybody in the military who is a medic or a corpsman, would look at this symbol as the symbol of medicine. This picture is a past, present, future theme. The bridge, you've got your guy standing guard, obviously in the top left, and then the bridge is dividing. One side is supposed to represent like an Iowa field, and the underneath the bridge, you're going to see little shapes. That's supposed to represent some of the huts in Afghanistan. So the bridge is dividing the two, and the guy standing point is protecting the right side from the left side. You're also going to notice that in the lower, underneath the bridge, those are actually some pill bottles. It's a little bit dark in that projection. I'm not sure if it's clear. But that is something else that's a huge issue, is the prescription drugs that these guys are on to deal with their symptoms from post-traumatic stress, and also just from their injuries, from all the, just from physical injuries that they've suffered from their They're prescribed a lot of drugs that make it difficult to function. It makes it difficult to, their reaction, you know, their drug reactions are really strong. It makes it difficult to get through the day with not only the symptoms from post-traumatic stress, but then the residuals that happen from the meds. I'm not going to get too far into this because that would be a whole nother discussion, but one thing I did want to point out is something that we need to be conscientious of is that the VA has double, this is a PBS report, the VA has double the number of accidental prescription drug overdoses compared with the national average. So we need to think of things like art or other things that can help as coping mechanisms in addition to therapy and medications, which are completely and totally necessary, but maybe there could be less. This one also has to do with the idea of past, present, future. Where they were was Iraq, and if you look closely, you're going to notice in the wall there's actually dog tags from all the guys in the cohort that worked on the mural. And there's a lot of themes that are repeated in different cohorts, even though they've never seen these murals, the previous cohort's mural, is that a lot of times there's like going to be a rising sun for a new day. A lot of times it's going to have something largely to do with nature as a place of peace. And this one, in addition, has that red thing in the middle of the water is actually a sacred heart. This one is also past, present, future. Past being the fire below. The present, if you see this painting up closely, you can kind of notice the anxiety attached to the guy's leg. As his buddy is pulling him up, and then the dog's pulling him up even further. But there's also words written within the rocks themselves. So this was kind of interesting. That was probably the first time that had happened, where they decided to actually use language in the mural in addition to the pictures. So where they were, the fire, where they're at, and where they want to go. So they're heading upwards. There's always a very hopeful atmosphere, and there's always a lot of hope within the classes and within the treatment to get past this. I mean, post-traumatic stress is something that's never going to go away. It's more of a matter of being able to manage the symptoms more effectively so it's less destructive to your daily life. This one has to do with homecoming. That's another theme that we work from. There's always a real big disconnect between veterans and their families when they come home because it's really hard when you're someone who's had these combat experiences to then come home to your family who is trying to understand where you're coming from but can't possibly because they've never been in that situation. And so this group of artists, this cohort, decided to have like a hallway where one side is the left side is the battle, is the combat. The center is all the demons that are obstructing them from getting to the right, which is the, you know, the happy family, the kids, and so forth. And then they had the central piece is some sort of direction towards the light. And that's, again, going to be something that's a repeat. A lot of times in the content is this movement towards the light. It's interesting how much these things repeat, and they don't even know each other. This cohort was really interesting because they were extremely demonstrative, which was unusual. These guys are much more open and sensitive than you think they are. They're just different in a lot of ways, but this group was really, really in support of one another. The other thing that was really interesting about this group, it's also a homecoming motif, is that we had Air Force, Marines, Army, and Navy represented in the group. So they wanted to make sure in the mural that you could find some sort of representation of each one of those branches of service. This is another homecoming. I mean, it's a huge, I don't know, I've never met a single combat veteran that hasn't had issues coming home and trying to reintegrate with their families. This one is, you know, a lot of times too, another repeat. We actually have it in this mural here too, where you have kind of like the quintessential like Iowa farmhouse representing home in America, and then, you know, the 2.2 kids or, you know, in the background, the silhouettes underneath the tree. And then we have the vet, and you'll notice this figure is the same figure that I used in that multiple tours of duty. So I actually didn't show them that painting. They found that image on their own. So most of the time I'll take my references from that disc of images that the combat photographer that was embedded with that Marine unit gave the Marine. So I a lot of times use those images, but sometimes I will just pull things straight off the internet. And it was just interesting because they pulled the same picture off to represent just the overwhelming weight of coming home and trying to reintegrate. In the water, you're going to notice it's like a blown up city in Iraq with the blood, you know, floating on the surface. This one, it's actually, I love all of them, of course, but this was definitely one of my favorites. Something I wanted to point out to everybody is that art in the military has a really long history. This is actually a print done by Paul Revere during the Revolutionary War. The military and art is not so disconnected as much as you think. There's actually a really deep history between arts and the military. And during the Revolution, Paul Revere used art as a propaganda. It was also used, you know, for strategic reconnaissance. It was used for, you know, map making, topography. So art has been a tool within the military since the beginning of our, at least our country. Also, I wanted to include the Civil War. This is actually Winslow Homer. He's one of the few artists of that time who actually served in the Civil War. A lot of artists and a lot of people would pay someone to serve in their place, and this was kind of interesting to see. I don't know how, what kind of background this audience has with art, but Winslow Homer is a really well-known painter, and he was also a combat vet in the Civil War. Something that's interesting, in World War I, the Army actually created a army of eight, eight professional illustrators who were civilians. And I'm not sure if you guys are familiar with John Singer Sargent. He's also an extremely well-known painter in history. And something that was unique about this war was the addition to of gas as a weapon. So in this painting, he's obviously showing victims of the gas. But these guys would tag along with the Marine or the military units, but they were actually civilians, the artists were. Whereas in World War II, you have combat artists now who are deployed with the, I apologize for these pictures, I took them off the internet, I couldn't find some stronger ones, but in any event, these guys, this was a Marine combat artist who basically they would sketch and fight, actually fight and sketch. So obviously the fighting comes first, but they were sketching in the moment of what they were seeing, and they were not civilians, they were active duty, which was interesting. This is also, I think everybody's maybe heard of that whole 2,000-yard stare. I'm not sure if Tom Lay was the guy who came up with that, but that image is definitely something that at least I've seen on a number of occasions. That was he was the deployed as a combat fighter as well as a combat artist. And Christopher Battles is actually the Marines have kept an artist full time. Since World War II, there is actually one full-time artist in the Marine Corps. None of the other branches have a combat artist. They have different art entities, but they don't have an actual combat artist. So this guy still exists. I don't know if his last name is really Battles, if that's something that he changed, but it seems a little too perfect. But I thought it was just interesting. And then finally, I wanted just to show a picture from Vietnam, because Vietnam was actually largely filmed. And by this time, the Air Force, the Marines, the Army, and the Navy all had art programs. And they really felt that it was important, even though it was being filmed, and even though obviously photography was, you know, completely abundant, that they would, they wanted the combat, the fighters to actually record what was happening in the moment to give us a true feeling of the experiences. Obviously, I'm going to be biased as a visual artist that photograph. I love photographs. I love combat photography. Nothing takes away from it. But definitely there has to be something to be said about the hand of the person there actually recording the event and creating the art. Now, however, we have smartphones. So there's Facebook, there's smartphones, and so a lot of stuff is recorded. And, you know, and a lot of guys get in a lot of trouble for that, too, because they're not supposed to be doing that, and then it gets posted on Facebook. We all hear those stories. But that's another way of of recording it, you know, in the moment, is some of these guys using their phones and posting stuff on Facebook. So next, I just wanted to talk to you guys about the methodology I use in my classes to help give you a clearer picture of how it works. First of all, it's not, when I first walk in the room with these guys, you know, the last thing they think that they're gonna be really interested in is making art. So it's not exactly an easy endeavor to get them engaged. A lot of times they make it some stereotypes, just as much as people have stereotypes about them, they have a lot of stereotypes about artists. Like, number one, they're hippies. So I always get asked, am I a hippie? And how many drugs have I taken? And am I into mushrooms? Or, you know, do I have any weed? So there's definitely some of that we have to get through. And then the next thing that always pops up is Mr. Bob Ross. Yeah, so Bob Ross always comes up in conversation, the happy trees. And you would be just completely surprised by the number of young men who watch Bob Ross. I mean, it's incredible. I've got three of them right here in front of me. So, and they'll tell you that later. Yeah, it's incredible. I mean, they weren't even born in the 70s when this guy was making these shows, but there's something about watching the painting that is very therapeutic. There you go. So, so it takes a little while to kind of win them over and kind of like, okay, this is something you don't have to know how to draw and paint. And the way that we do it is I start off with mind mapping, because I am a teacher, right? So a lot of graphic organizers, lots of mind mapping, using words that then turn into pictures. So these are not good images, and I apologize. A lot of times when I'm working in these classes, I mean to record each step, and then I forget, because I get involved in what I'm doing, and I forget to do that. So these next two images are samples of some of the we have conversations, let's say if it's past, present, future, I'll just write past on the board, and then anything that pops in their mind, we just put in that underneath that column. Present, anything that comes to mind, put it in that column. Future, anything that comes to mind, put it in that column. And then things that start to be a commonality between the group, because everybody has individual experiences in combat, but a lot of them have commonality, so they're not exactly right. So we try to focus, when we're working on the collaborative artwork, we're trying to focus on the commonalities that these guys have so that we can create something that everybody's interested in. It's very important that one person doesn't dominate. Once we come up with the words that we want to focus on, then I start asking them, you know, okay, when you think of, if you say past and you say if you say afraid, then, and a lot of times they'll open up really quickly. It's very cool. It's super surprising to me sometimes how quickly they'll talk about stuff. But in any event, they'll talk about how they felt in the past, and they'll say alone, they'll say afraid, they'll say, you know, there's a lot of different descriptors that come up. And then it's like, okay, what does alone look like? You know, what image comes to mind when you think of alone? You know, or what image comes up when you think of, you know, pride, or, you know, and so forth. So we go through a process of pairing pictures with words. And a lot of times somebody in the group will, once we get started on this brainstorming session, somebody will, I'll just say, by chance, is anybody out there actually just have an idea that popped up? And almost 100% of the time, someone will stand up and go, you know what, I had an idea. What if we do X, Y, Z? And then once he starts it, then we start drawing stuff on the board, and then people start taking turns coming up to the dry erase board and drawing stuff. And then together, we then edit it down. After we get the basis of the scene that we want to create, then I send them to the computers to start getting references to work from. And then guys will start doing sketches. And then the next step after that is taking all of the reference and all the sketches together. And usually I'll help them with the concept drawing so that it can be done kind of efficiently and quickly. This one's not done by me. This is one of the guys. This one was done by me. This is actually the initial concept drawing for the Veteran Mural Project mural that you saw earlier. That was the picture that had the empty wall of a building next to it. And so this is, you know, so then I'll take all the stuff that they've come up with and I'll help put it into a drawing. And then once I do that drawing, I just have them project it. That's one thing that is really important for me to do, is to let these guys know that there's no need for you to know how to draw. We project everything. So any reason that they come up with why they can't do something, I've already got an answer for it. So this, you know, I've been doing it long enough. I'm like, nope, caught that one. We're good. Then they'll project it, and that is a pretty straightforward process. But the other thing that's cool is when you're working large, it always looks cool. It looks cool to have the drawing projected. You know, it's like you're already starting forward in the motion of getting the thing done, and then we start painting it, and we just paint it in layers. What I'll do is a lot of times I'll help them mix the colors, and then I'll just point at stuff for people to paint, and it's surprising the skills that come out. So, you know, and it's surprising to the confidence that comes out, where they'll just do it. They won't second guess themselves. They'll just, you know, a lot of times when I teach adults, they're really, really afraid to try things. They're really afraid to start things. With this group, a lot of times they just have a lot of confidence. They'll just go for it. So we'll go through several layers till we get to the final. This is actually a really good example of a picture of transition. You know, these guys, the concept being that transitioning from the military into civilian life, getting a job, you know, the stuff in the background to the left is obviously a war combat scene, and then the stuff getting blown up that's kind of hard to see in this image is stuff like tricycles and wedding rings and pill bottles and boots and all the different things that just get completely annihilated when they come home trying to reintegrate. And then all of those things are being blown off over to this little house and all those things are being used to reassemble. So when they come home, and especially with multiple deployments, every time they come home, they have to rebuild. And so it's a conversation starter about, you know, what happens when they come back and what kind of rebuilding do they have to do. The figure is fairly obvious, you know, transitioning from, you know, from a soldier to a civilian. And then the figures in the front are representative of, you know, this is essentially all one person. So it's, you know, who they were, the black silhouette, and then who they're kind of feeling like now, and where they're going is the reflection of the guy in the center. Another way that we've done it before is to take something that already exists. This is Norman Rockwell's triple portrait. So the guys took this as a starting off point, and then we integrated a triple self-portrait of a service member. So this is the process, and then this is the final. So basically, it's what the idea is that he's looking himself in the mirror, and the little boy with the toy gun is what he thought being in the military was like. He always dreamed about being in the military as a little kid. The painting that he's creating is how he feels inside, and then the person actually sitting there is who he is today. So he's looking at himself of, you know, what he thought it was going to be like, and then it's transforming into how he feels inside. And then the pictures to the right and left, a lot of times artists will put reference photos on their easels to help them come up with images or to, you know, paint things realistically. And so they chose to have images of their, you know, some of their issues as references, you know, helping out their guy, losing a buddy, you know, reconnecting with their kid, you know, and so on. And then I had to show the painting in the exhibition. So it's a whole process. It starts at one point and hopefully ends up in an exhibition. The other thing I wanted to share with you is that we don't only do painting. Some guys aren't really into painting. Some are into writing. Some are into sculpture. And so I've created a mask-making project with the theme of internal, external. Internally, how do you feel about yourself? Externally, how do you feel people viewed you? And I give them these, I wish I would have brought a picture of it for you. I give them these really basic paper pulp masks that are completely generic. And then I give them this stuff called Scopamold, and it kind of dries like a, kind of like a hard paper mache, where they can build it out. Let me skip forward a little bit. They can build it out and add stuff This is a better one. You can see the blue face that you're seeing is actually the face that I've given them, and then he painted on top of it and then collaged some of these pieces of glass as tears. But all that stuff you see, do I have another one of that? No. All that stuff you see behind it is a whole nother face on the other side that he's built out of this sculpted mold. So sometimes definitely having something that's a little bit more tactile and three-dimensional is a little bit more useful. Sometimes the two-dimensional surface doesn't really do the trick. But they are all extremely personal and have they're really powerful. In this exhibit, I actually had the masks hanging from meat hooks that I had made, so it kind of fit the motif of how they were feeling. This one's interesting. I'm not sure how many football fans I've got in here, but Junior Seau's cousin was in my class, and they're actually the tribal group that I'm completely forgetting right now that I'll think in a second is what's going on here. It's a warrior face. So instead of actually building out on the face, he chose to paint it. And I think it's just a really powerful work. What ends up happening after they go through the art classes, a lot of times they start pursuing art. They use the art. The thing that's cool about teaching art, the practice of making art, is that they can then take that home and use it as a coping mechanism. So when things are starting to get a lot of anxiety building or stress is building, it's a place to go to stop the bad thoughts from happening. So they'll end up making artwork on their own and then sending me either pictures of it or sending the images, the actual artwork to me to put into art exhibitions. But it's a way for them to release some of the stories and some of the experiences that they've had. I've also had a handful of guys actually go back to school and study art, which is, not necessarily a great idea to try to become an artist and make a living at it, but I will totally encourage them to go into animation or something where they could actually make a living. No, but in any event, it's really gratifying to me to see them using it outside of class, because they're not always going to be surrounded by doctors and therapists. They're not always going to have those people around, although those people are very important. They need to learn their own methods of coping so that they can continue to move forward on with their lives. So these are just a couple more of independent works of art from veterans. A lot of times, too, they'll include artist statements that are just so incredibly powerful when they're positioned next to the work. Now, I'm talking about all these positive benefits of making art. There is a lot of evidence-based research out there in healthcare communities, not necessarily focused on post-traumatic stress, but in healthcare, just in general, people with cancer or severe depression and so forth. There's a lot of research out there that points to major reductions in stress and anxiety, decreases in depression. I see this myself. Increases in community engagement, which is hugely important, increases in self-confidence and overall well-being. There's actually a program in the UK called Arts on Prescription, and basically what happens is the healthcare community, so the hospitals and doctors and therapists, actually prescribe art to their patients, and patients are sent to community art organizations who provide some sort of service in the arts for that patient. So I kind of wanted to end my presentation. I'm going to show you a video, but just talk to you a little bit. If you are interested, if you Google Arts on Prescription, you can see a lot of different things on the internet that will describe how it was used. And I just, a lot of times when I'm complaining about something, I feel it necessary to come up with some sort of solution. And this is something that I think would be a way to go, is some sort of idea of the VA or the DOD actually collaborating with community arts organizations to help in some of these therapeutic benefits that things like art can provide. And it doesn't have to be art. Art's not for everybody. Sometimes it can, you know, in San Diego, surfing is huge. You know, the guys get a lot of huge benefit from surfing, mountain biking. You know, it can be music. You know, there's just a whole variety of things that could be offered to these guys that just need to be, more information needs to be out there, more access needs to be out there, and I think that it would go a long way in bringing these guys all the way home. That being said, I have one last thing I'm going to show you. It's a video that I had made by a filmmaker in San Diego. It's actually the one of those like Kickstarter videos where you, it was my fundraising campaign for the Veteran Mural Project. I think it's a really good video because you get to actually see individuals that went through combat arts have conversations about their experiences and then how art is beneficial to them. After we have that, it takes about 7 minutes, and then after that video, we actually have, we're going to turn up the lights, we're going to do the question and answer, and included with me on the question and answer is actually three veteran artists who are Johnson County Community College students who helped, among three of six that helped create this mural, or create this painting, and they are willing to talk about the work to give you some idea of what the content is about, as well as answer your questions. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and start the video.
I'm Chris. I'm from Ventura, California. Currently in the Marine Corps, still active duty sergeant.
My name is Aaron Rare. I was a sergeant. I'm Marine Corps retired. I went to go to Iraq to participate in the war.
So it's been four to Iraq, two to Afghanistan.
The bloodiest year of the war, the bloodiest months, and we are supposedly in the worst, most dangerous place in the world at the time, Ramadi. And I happen to have the most dangerous job in the war, which was a turret gunner.
A lot of people out there, that you know, they could say, you know, they remember their first kiss, they remember this, about the very first experiences of their lives. One thing you don't forget is your first firefight.
My first real ambush, I'll never forget. I got engaged on the right about 15 feet away, and there was three of them. You know, for a minute, it felt like a hornet's nest. It's a miracle I'm here, and I didn't get hit. They had the drop on me.
I remember seeing Stuart run up behind me. I look over at him and he gets up and he starts shooting. I remember hearing that crack. I see him knock his head back. And we was doing the medevac and Hogan yells out to me. I'm like, what? He's like, shot. I look down at my arm and my whole arm just covered in blood. I didn't feel anything.
I engaged the one on the second floor left first, hit him, hit the one on the right, and they both went down. Nobody tells you that people don't die right away. And I still hear them, you know what I mean? Like their screams.
After my first one, I puked. I'll be honest, I puked. I didn't know what I did. Adrenaline, after it leaves your system, your whole body goes into spasms. They slowly stop becoming people. They started to become target silhouettes because it was a means of survival.
Yeah, that's what combat is. It's hell. That's all it is.
One of my best friends, Darren, he said, Chris, you're not the same anymore. What are you talking about, man? I'm the same guy. No, man, you've changed. He had to be there when he saw me come off the train with a bullet hole in my arm.
Some of my symptoms of PTSD started in country. I can look back now and see that, like insomnia, nightmares, the hypervigilance, always be on guard.
My dad first noticed it and he asked me if I was okay. I was walking around and checking cars, windows, roofs.
I responded to things differently, noises, and than normal people respond. I responded more with military response. I remember the first time I went to the grocery store after I got back, somebody dropped a box or something on the next aisle. I ducked out of my shopping cart. And I kind of look around, nobody else is doing that. I can't do this. Just left my cart, walked out, got on the phone, got out of there. Yes.
When the nightmares come in, for me, I didn't really notice them too much. It was, my girlfriend that would notice. I'd be punching the wall or something. I have no recollection of it. I would have full-blown conversations of things I'd done, but she would ask me in the morning, well, do you remember any of this? No, not at all. I brushed it off. I didn't think much of it.
I just thought I was a Marine. I'm a combat Marine now. This is what combat Marines do. They wake up in the middle of the night and scream.
My name is Elizabeth Washburn. I'm the founder of Combat Arts. At Combat Arts, I provide art classes for veterans returning from war from Iraq and Afghanistan. I've been teaching veterans for about 6 years. With my classes, I use my skills as a professional artist and art teacher to help them to convey some of the experiences, thoughts, and ideas that they have about their war experiences through the visual arts. What's different about Combat Arts is that at Combat Arts, we use professional artists to guide the classes, to teach the classes, so that we're actually teaching the skill set of how to draw and paint, in addition to utilizing the therapeutic benefits of making art. At Combat Arts, we believe that art is inherently therapeutic, and we do not administer clinical therapy, being artists and art teachers.
It's easier for me to express what's going on through art than my words, I think.
I'm not really that good at talking when it comes to talking about my experiences. When you finally get it out on paper, it's a way to vent.
For me, it kind of feels like it lightens a load a little bit each time.
Instead of having that film reel going over and over and over in your head, you can put that experience out on paper. And it's almost a way of changing it to a different medium, putting it on a different perspective, because then you can look at the picture now. You're not playing in your head anymore.
In addition to the art classes, we also curate exhibitions of combat artwork that provide an opportunity for the public to get a little bit more of an intimate interaction with veterans, and it also gives veterans the opportunity to be recognized for their artistic achievements as well as their service.
I like watching other people look at my art and just eavesdropping and hearing what they have to say, because they'll pull something totally different out of it. And I think that's cool about art. It's different for everybody. So I could use it for therapy, and then somebody else sees it and they see it for something totally different, which I think is rad.
We would like to expand our efforts into a public art project that reaches out into the streets. We are calling it the Veteran Mural Project. With this project, we're hoping to create large-scale murals that will be exhibited on exteriors of buildings throughout San Diego. So in order for the Veteran Mural Project to be successful, we need your support. Please consider donating whatever makes sense to you, and thank you so much for supporting Combat Arts.
This is where I'm at now. I gotta live with it, and my only way to express it is through art. I got no other ways to express it like other people. This is the only way I can.
Good evening, folks. Thanks for coming out. Just to start things off, give you a little explanation of what's going on here. We kind of went along the lines of the past, present, future scenario going on here. As you can see to the left, you've got the arm reaching out in the uniform, the hand reaching out towards the Kevlar helmet. The individual stepping over the chasm, acting as like the dividing line going up through the picture, and he's partially dressed in a uniform and moving forward into a civilian, more of a college student attire, with the Chuck Taylor shoes on and the hoodie sweatshirt. And then you got the cap for graduation as a sign of moving forward in life. It goes from dark to light also. You got the bluish brown hues on the left side of like Iraq and Afghanistan, moonlight hitting the sands and the terrain there. Very barren, no real greenery, nothing bright in that environment. And as you step over to the other side, you've got the greens, the future, the farmhouse or the home in the background, American flag on the flagpole signifying the coming home aspect. In the chasm that they're stepping over through that transition, you have images of war. There's a blown up Humvee, say from an IED or whatever, various pieces and parts of things that you would see in a combat zone. There's one piece in there that looks like an eye. It's kind of like the eye of Sauron off The Hobbit, the ever-watching eye, the demons. It's some of the challenges that you overcome as you're crossing over and coming back. So that gives you a little bit of an explanation of what's going on with the mural.
Thank you. And would anybody like to start with questions? This is something we did actually since Saturday. I met them on Saturday for the first time. We had a couple-hour meeting. They came up with the concept. We came up with the concept together doing the mind mapping exercise. We met on Sunday for a couple hours, Monday for about a few hours, and yesterday was the marathon. So it was they really showed up. They were awesome. They were open to doing it. It was a fantastic group of people.
My question is, did Chris's agent get involved in the modeling?
Yeah. It does look like you. It is you.
Yeah. Actually, I did. When we were kind of trying to figure out, when we decided that we were going to use this, a figure as a central theme, we kind of went through a few different ideas, and then ultimately decided on that stance, I guess. And then I actually wasn't supposed to be in it. And the other guy who was doing this with us, Eric, he just couldn't stand right.
Yeah.
So I was like, here, let
horrible
me show
model.
You.
Not a good model.
Yeah. I was like, here, let me show you. And then they just snapped a bunch of pictures, like, all right, we're good. And I was like, what? Now it's me?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm amazed with the level of quality and professionalism in it. So my question is, before the military, did you all have art experiences, whether in, you know, high school or if you had higher education before? Because that's pretty amazing.
No, me personally, I've never touched a paintbrush before in my life. Never, not once. This is the first time.
Well, I would say that all credit to the amount of quality definitely goes to Elizabeth. She definitely helped us out with a lot of the harder parts. We basically kind of painted by numbers and let her fill in the details.
We had a short period of time. A lot of times I will fill in the blanks. It's a collaboration between the artist and them, so it's more of a collaboration than anything else. But there was one individual that's not here that did a lot of the painting of the stuff inside the fissure that actually has taken some classes, and he was a rock star. Saved the day yesterday.
So I have a second question. Now that you all have participated in this, is this changing your career path?
No.
I'm not changing jobs for it.
No.
But it makes you look at art differently. Though,
I think it would be interesting to maybe pursue art as a hobby now. That's probably not something I considered before. Maybe not necessarily painting as a medium, but seeing the therapeutic qualities that are involved with it, it's an interesting concept I hadn't thought about before.
It was fun.
Well, I was wondering, you know, for all of you, you know, what were your initial thoughts and feelings as you were approaching, you know, this process?
My thoughts were, I really have to paint. I was like, I've never painted before in my life, so I mean, painting for me was, I can't even draw a stick man. So painting for me was probably the last thing on my mind. I thought we were actually gonna do like a statue. I could probably do a statue. But it's like, we got a painting, not so much.
I don't know, it's much more than painting the side of a house or something like that.
Yeah.
it was a different experience. I learned a lot. First time working with acrylics or ever playing with acrylics in an actual canvas. So it was, she enlightened us on a lot of things. So I really appreciate her for doing that.
Okay. Well, given you were feeling that way as you were approaching it, what had you been willing to do it?
She was there. She was there, and she said she can fix anything. And that was my biggest concern, was to like mess it up. Yeah. You know, I've never painted, so messing it up will be bad. So she's like, don't worry about it. And she walked us through it.
Yeah, it's kind of intimidating thinking about making something that's going to be, you know, potentially here on campus for a really long time and then being scared of messing it up.
Yeah.
But yeah, we I think we all just put a lot of faith in Elizabeth, and it turned out really well.
I think the...
I believe it's going up in our new Veterans Center. We just opened up a new Veterans Center on campus so we can help... students in a larger capacity, and we have a new lounge area that's kind of attached to that where students can go study and just kind of hang out and stuff like that between their classes, and we have a wall that it's going to be going up on.
Several of this veteran students that participated in this project actually are moving on in their careers to work with other veterans and helping them with counseling and so forth, so it's a really unique group of people.
If none of you had any artistic information in the first place, how would you get involved with this?
Well, I see Kenna, the director of our veteran services. She's and actually my boss. I work in veteran services, but you know, I'm not saying she made me. No, I don't. Yeah, she just. She approached several students about it and asked if I and asked me also if I was interested. And I said, well, you know what, painting's not really my thing, but you know, I'll give it a shot. You know, so I'm glad I did.
I had some family members that painted with oils and stuff in the past, and it's like, well, maybe there's a little bit of that made it into my bloodline. You can only find out one way, so give it a try.
For me, basically, I was talking to Ken. I'm not actually a student yet, per se. I'm enrolled. I'm actually still active military. I'm still in. November 20th will be my 20th year. So I'll be retired, and then I'm going back to school here. Thank you. So, and I asked her, I was like, is there any kind of, you know, veterans programs that's going on, you know, that I can volunteer for? And she mentioned this, and I was on it.
Usually have 2-hour classes once a week, so we'll work on it for 2 hours, and then we'll have between. It depends on. Sometimes I have 5 weeks with a cohort. We've changed the structure now where it's going to be the full 10 weeks, and then with the Veteran Mural Project, we work together for 4 months.
So the experience of our students here. Was similar, but not really the same as what the folks go through in the group out in San Diego, which is much more in-depth and ongoing. Is that right?
Well, it's more crash, like you said. More so it's, crash. Yeah, so, they,
so
it's the same.
A lot of hours at one point.
Yeah, it's the same stuff.
Okay.
But it's just condensed.
So my question for the group is, what did you notice as you were going through this process? What was going on for you guys over the process here? And maybe a more difficult question is, and how was it relating to your experience and adjustment to coming home?
Well, for me personally, like since I knew that we were going to be putting it up in our Veteran Resource Center, I didn't necessarily try to draw from personal experience, more on the theoretical future, I guess, for lack of a better word, about you know the hopefulness and the future side of it, and so I thought it was important to incorporate an academic aspect to the painting.
To build on top of that, I think we all felt like that the what we did in the military and how we've earned our education benefits to move forward felt that was a key ingredient to it. But also during the thought process when we were trying to put things together, to we were feeding off each other to come up with a common core, common theme. And then figuring out how, even though we had the commonalities on there, the individual commonalities were still able to be individual, even though you had a core commonality across the spectrum.
For me, I mean, I came in the military when I was 18, so this is basically my only job. This is all I've done for the last 20 years. So therefore, I was letting go of something that I've been doing basically, you know, twice my, you know, my age. Now I'm stepping over this threshold that I don't know anything about. I don't know if I'm gonna fall, I don't know if I'm gonna rise, I don't know. So therefore, that's why I'm reaching out, trying to get my degree to see what my future holds.
Generally, I try to work from their experiences because generally they'll be more interested in making something that has to do with them. But if you know, if there was a way to structure a class where we could do some research, or there was an interest in reading and writing, maybe I could illustrate or have them recreate something like you're talking about. It's a neat idea.
Combining art students with maybe a program here
that could be ongoing? I have no idea. I'm not going to.
I think that's a fabulous idea. Yeah.
There you go. Yeah, so that is a wonderful idea. I personally head back to San Diego tomorrow. So I have no. I'd happily give advice or give my structure or my. You know, my teaching template or anything that would be helpful though. All right.
One more.
As an artist, you said that you were initially hesitant to paint other people's experiences. Laying aside the negative connotation of that word and laying aside the subject matter of the psyche of how do you think that what you're doing is different from photographers, say, or the
other, or do you think so? I mean, if you were going to categorize my painting, you would call it narrative painting, which would be really similar to like documenting, like you're saying, like a film or you know, photograph. As far as how, so the question is, how is what I'm doing different than just? Because I'm not there, and because it's more of a reaction to the experiences that I have with the individuals that I meet more than the actual events themselves. So it's kind of a reinterpretation, I guess, of what I'm observing with the individuals that I'm interacting with. And you mean in the combat paintings?
Yeah.
that was, you know, that was really revolving around. At some point, I realized that it's not really exploitive because they really don't have time to advocate for themselves because they've got too much stuff to do, you know, to get going. So I really was looking at it more as an kind of like advocacy and like a social geared artwork, more so than some of my personal stuff is definitely much different. It's like the content will be and the what I make will be actually different. It's not quite so not quite so literal, for lack of a better way to say it, not so representational. It's a little more abstracted. So what I was doing with that combat artwork was specifically for sharing information. So, yeah. So it was like, here, I'm going to make a painting about this to have a, to start a conversation about this.
Do you feel like after giving the 20 years to the artists and keep America safe, do you feel like you'll be supported as you venture on?
Yes.
Has a group inspired that through this project? Knowing that someone.
She's been yelling at me the whole time, so so it feels like I'm still in the Navy, so but no, yes, I feel that, especially coming here in Kansas, believe it or not, there's a lot more military than you would think, and there's a lot of people that are very helpful. Even I mean, especially here at JUCO, helping me with all the paperwork that I need. So right now, so far, it's so good.
Yeah, I personally, I transitioned out of the Army after 7 years last summer and started going to school here at JCCC. And I was actually really surprised by the amount of, not only the number of student veterans we have here on campus, but the large amount of support that we have, not only from the Veterans Center, but from the just the school in general. It's absolutely amazing. And I feel lucky that this is where I landed, you know, as opposed to someplace else that maybe was just trying to get their hands on some of that sweet GI Bill money. Yeah, so I really appreciate this place. I think it's really it's going to be a great launching point for going into the future.
I'm in a different situation. I'm back here on a voc rehab, so I did 13 years in the Air Force and got out and was using my trades that I learned in the service, and I've had to change careers because service-connected injuries. So now I'm learning a new trade. I'm actually working. I work for the college now out of the Veterans Resource Center. I do the community outreach and engage the community to try and bring in more resources for the college, create resources in the community for the students graduating from the college or while they're going to school to help not only the veteran but the veteran's family, because it's a total package. That's a key part of that's been proven is that to keep a veteran in school and to see completion, you've got to take care of those extracurricular things that generally cause them to pull out. And a lot of times that's work, daycare, housing, those kind of issues. If you don't have those key elements taken care of, being able to keep them focused and engaged in the school for completion is going to be hard to do. And I've kind of gone full circle from where I used to work in construction, all that, to where it's a shirt and tie, slacks kind of deal, and a complete change of vocabulary and mannerisms and way of going about conducting business. And without being out here and the support I've had from the college out here to be able to make that transition and get to where I am now, I don't think there's another place in town that would be able to provide that assistance the way it was provided.
Well, we thank you for your service.
Johnson County Community College it's been just hugely impressive. Just the structure, just the people, everybody working here. The Contemporary Museum has just been amazing. It's really, this place is fantastic.
I'd like to thank you for what you've done. Every time that's another thing, yeah, for better your head.
he's still in San Diego, and he went to San Diego State University and studying art right now.
Oh, yeah?
And helped to go to San Diego on Thanksgiving. So I'm going to plan to visit.
Oh, good.
But thank you very much for giving your talent.
Oh, absolutely. It's a total labor of love.
And he went to Blue Valley North also.
Did he really? What is his name? Just because you never, never. When are you going to be there again?
Actually, twice. Every Thanksgiving and then again early December.
Are you going to be there December 7th?
December 7th.
Anyway, we can talk after. I'll invite you to something. Yeah, there's
I'll come
okay, we'll talk to you after.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, you're so welcome.
All right, everybody, please.